Head for the Yorkshire Dales, and one of the first things you notice is mile upon mile of dry stone walls, snaking across the fields and hills as far as the eye can see. Built entirely without the use of mortar, these beautiful walls rely on their intricate construction and strength to withstand decades, sometimes centuries, of treacherous upland winters. The craft of dry stone walling is still thriving today, as miles of new walls are still being built, while existing ones need to be restored. These dry stone wallers are totally dedicated to their craft and have become master craftsmen through the Dry Stone Walling Association.
Dry stone walls in Yorkshire have been here for about 250 years and they mark the landscape. When you think of Yorkshire, you think of dry stone walls, particularly in the Dales. The walls were built to mark property. They're also to protect, keep livestock in, keep predators out. More specifically, as the time moved on into the middle of the 19th century, when there was a big, big survey of the landscape, then these long, straight walls that seemed to soar over peaks and go in any direction, that's when those were built, gangs of wallers swarming the landscape, stone being collected on sledges. It's ironic that as the walls were being built and they were covering the landscape, there was also a lot of protest about the ugliness of them. They were regarded as being ugly, they were man-made, they were scars, they weren't natural. Particularly in the environment that I'm standing in now, in the Yorkshire Sculpture Park, where there are ha-has, which are retaining dry stone walls, and they were built so that they couldn't actually be seen from the great house that administered the landscape around it. Whereas now, as people walk by them, they admire them for how they've been built and where they are and how they look. If you see something that's beautifully built in dry stone, there's something really, really pleasurable about it, that it's held together by itself without being filled with cement or mortared or whatever. It seems as though it grows from the landscape rather than dominates it. At the moment we're working in the Yorkshire Sculpture Park. I say we, I work with three other wallers who wall to the same level, and we're all very keen about walling, and we're also great friends. And we were commissioned to restore some ancient ha-has that form a lot of the border markings of the Yorkshire Sculpture Park. These special walls, which were built in 1760, a lot of them have become derelict. And so our job really has been to restore them. And in the restoration, we also have to include things like gate posts, gateways, stiles, steps, and so forth. So we put in these steps, which break up the ha-ha either side of it, and lead us to a squeeze stile, which is further up the wall. And we've just installed these brand new dry stone steps that have replaced a wooden staircase that in actual fact just rotted away, but they'll be there for a long time. Next to this double ha-ha, which looks like an ordinary independent dry stone wall, and it's quite low here, it's only what, about 3 feet high. So as I walk up the wall, it gets higher and higher, and the landscape lifts, and here it's about 7 feet tall, and I've moved away from it, and I'm climbing up these steps which we put in, big, crude lumps of stone that are now make it easy for us to climb and secure as well. And eventually end up at this, a squeeze stile. It looks exactly what it is. It's set into a dry stone wall, these supporting pieces either side, and you squeeze your way through it. This section of wall has just been restored, and beyond it, it's derelict. But the way it's been left gives a absolutely perfect example of how a dry stone wall is constructed. As you can see, it's really two walls, but you notice that in between the two sides to the wall there's this stuff which is called filling or heartings, and these pieces, and when you're putting them in, are as important as the stones that are either side of it. Halfway up the wall, you can see it's about the height of my knee. There's this big stone here, which is called, it goes right across the wall, which is called a through. It goes through the wall. And it ties together all the stones that are below it, and these will be spaced out along a wall about every metre. Above that, notice that the stone is now getting smaller, thinner, but there's still the filling, still there, and it's getting narrower until at the top of the wall here, in the same, working in the same way that the through works, this, which is called a cope stone, a coping stone, ties together the top of the wall. All of these next to each other, snugly pulled together tightly, and they hold everything between there and the through stone together. I developed my walling skill just through, in the early stages, by just doing it, by assembling stone. Also, I was motivated to do so, I wanted to learn. Eventually, after a few years of pottering about, I joined the association, the Drystone Walling Association, and then learned the craft from the beginnings, walling everywhere and everything. And obviously, the more you do and the more you handle and the more experience you get, the more it becomes part of a way of life. The beauty of it is that once you've got the skills, like any other craft, there comes a point, particularly with walling, where as you're putting stone on stone, it takes care of itself and the mind can go elsewhere. And it almost has a sort of a meditative quality about it that is the thing that really, really attracts me to it. In Yorkshire, there's more walls in terms of the density of the landscape than anywhere else in Britain. If you can imagine the work process, it approximately will take one man a year to build a mile of wall. So when you see all those thousands of miles, that web of walling, particularly in the Dales, and you look where it is and where it goes, and imagine how it's built, and put into that the man hours that it took to build it, you're talking about something that is just beyond your imagination. But it's there. What is interesting that now it's being more respected than it was when it was originally built. People look at it and marvel at it and say, we want to keep that because that's part of our history and part of our heritage. And it defines the landscape. That is the Yorkshire landscape. When people think of the Yorkshire landscape, they think, first of all, I think of Drystone Walls.